Well, good morning. I'm going to have you take out your bulletin, and you've got an insert in there, and you're going to want to have that Bible that's under the seat in front of you. If you didn't bring a Bible, I'm going to be on page 966, I think it is, reading some verses from 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We are, I was going to say we're starting a new series, but we're not. We're picking up where we left off with an old series. We got about halfway through 2 Corinthians some months ago and took a little detour for some topical teaching, so now we're back in the text. And I drew the first passage, and I am so glad I did. It is a remarkable passage. It highlights in a number of ways the newness, just the radical newness of our life in Christ and what happens when we embrace Jesus and the Holy Spirit indwells us and we become a totally different person. I became a Christian about 40 years ago, and I had stumbled into a church, and they gave me a Bible. I read the part of the Bible and became a Christian. I went back the following Sunday, so you got to figure this is the second time I'd been in a church basically in my life. I mean, when I was a kid, my parents shipped me off to Sunday school, but it's the second time on my own will, you know, willingly I was in church. And so I walked up to the pastor, and I said, I became a Christian. I became a Christian. And he smiled and said, Joe, he says, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old things have passed. Behold, all things have become new. And he quoted a verse from our passage today. Boy, little did I know just how different my life would be. And so we're going to look at this. This passage has some marvelous imagery in here and some familiar verses, and it'll be very meaningful to us as we go through here, I hope. My little guy here is doing some crazy things in my hand. Maybe I need a new battery. We'll see. Well, I'm going to start reading 2 Corinthians chapter 5 on page 966, starting with verse 11. Paul writes, therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. But what we are is known to God, and I hope it is known also to your conscience. Paul's going back and forth with a church that had struggled a little bit to receive his leadership. And so there are some issues behind the scene here that we won't go into, but just be aware of that. Paul says then, verse 12, we are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you cause to boast about us so that you may be able to answer those who boast about outward appearance and not about what is in the heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it's for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ controls us. Because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died, and he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God for our sake. He made him to be sin who knew no sin so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Remarkable passage with so much great stuff in it. And I had to make a decision this week. Do I go through this whole passage in kind of summary form, not really drilling down in any particular place, but kind of touching a little bit on everything? Or do I pick a portion of the passage and really kind of drill down to some of the meat of it? And I decided the answer to that question is yes, that I'm going to do both here today. So what you have on your outline is an overview of the passage, and I'm going to give you all your blanks at the gate here. And then we're going to look at one aspect of this passage, one aspect of this new life in Christ that'll lead, I think, very naturally into our communion celebration at the end of the service. But you'll have on your outline then the rest of the passage kind of in summary fashion and kind of get the big picture. And you can take those outlines then into your small groups to ask questions or make contributions. And I think it'll be helpful. So we're going to jump right in and fill in a whole bunch of blanks here. So get ready as we do. The first blank is a new life pathway. A new life pathway. This is the first aspect of this whole new life thing. And it really consists of two things, and I'm going to put them both up here, and we're not even going to talk about them now because this is what I'm going to come back to. We're going to really focus on the doctrine of reconciliation here this morning as our segue to communion. But you'll want to write this in, peace with God through the death of Christ. This is the message of the gospel. But the newness doesn't stop there. The newness continues, a new life pathway that leads us to a new life perspective, a whole new way of thinking about life, and especially a new way of thinking about people. Your blanks here are a new view of people and a new view of Messiah, a new view of Messiah. For those of you who might not know, Christ is not Jesus' last name. Christ means Messiah. And we chuckle, but we have to discipline ourselves as we read our New Testaments to remember that, I think. And the reason is, in this particular scenario, the new view of people for Paul really comes out of the new view of Messiah. Jesus is the archetype. And here's what I mean. Paul says in the passage that although we once regarded Messiah, Christ, according to the flesh, we no longer do so. And what he means by that is we once looked at Jesus externally, and based on that evaluation, he was a nobody. He was dirt from a podunk province on the Eastern Roman Empire who was crucified by the Romans. He was a peasant. He was a nobody in his own society. He had no formal rabbinic education. And he stirred up people. We got rid of them, hung them on a cross to discourage others who would do the same according to the flesh. Christ was a nobody. But then, of course, the risen Christ meets Paul on Damascus Roads, and Paul realizes that that nobody was a real somebody, and that in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, that in weakness, in brokenness, in shame, that the whole social status, the whole understanding of how humans evaluate one another in the ancient world and today as well, was going to be turned on its head, and we would no longer regard now people, a new view of people, we would no longer regard one another according to the flesh, according to how much money we had, what kind of car we drove, or what kind of chariot we drove back then. What our education was, all this, how buff we looked, all this stuff becomes wood, hay, and stubble at one level. So that Paul can look back at his life later in Philippians and he can write, I was really, I was a real status guy, man. I was a Hebrew of Hebrews, Pharisee of Pharisees. According to the law, I was blameless. And he says, I count that all as loss now because I have a totally new view of people, and it comes from a new view of Messiah, not regarding Messiah according to the flesh. I wish we had time to camp on that because that's life-transforming, folks. That is life-transforming. And then if that's not enough, we have a new life purpose. We talked about the need for purpose last week a little bit. And here Paul talks about us being ambassadors for Christ, motivated by the fear of God and the love of Christ. And it's just a beautiful, beautiful picture of what we have been called to do. There's one phrase in this particular part of your outline in the passage that just knocks me out every time I read it. You know, Paul says there in verses 15 or 18 through 20, in the middle there, he says, we are ambassadors for Christ. He says, God making his appeal through us. Stop and think about that. God wants to make his appeal to this world through you and I. That is mind-boggling. Folks, that is meaning, purpose, like there is no other. Now, that's kind of our overview. We're going to come back in a minute and focus on the new life pathway. But I look at that, and I have to chuckle, because when I walked into that church 40-some years ago, and that pastor said, Joe, if anybody's in Christ, he's a new creation, I was clueless about the significance of that big picture like we see it on the screen here. I came to Christ because my life had fallen apart emotionally. I just basically went crazy with an anxiety reaction, started searching spiritually. and became a Christian, and I found peace with reality, peace with God through the death of Christ. Little did I know that this new life was going to involve a whole new life perspective on people, a whole new purpose for living and meaning that would affect everything I do, the way I spend my time, the way I spend my money, who I marry, how I raise my kids. All of life is different because of what happened to me 41 years ago when I received Jesus. I think about this new life perspective and this new view of people. I was very, before I was a Christian, very much caught into the social stratification and, you know, back then we didn't call it this, but identity politics of my group, your group, I'm cool, you're not, all this kind of stuff. You know, I had my buddies who, you know, we were cool, you know, we were the surfers or the musicians or whatever, and this other group, these people were not cool, I didn't like to hang out with them, and these people were cooler than me, and you know, you try to schmooze with them, and all this nonsense, okay? And I got saved, and I came into a college group at Community Baptist Church down here, now Journey of Faith, with all kinds of people I had nothing in common with before I became a Christian. And some of them were really weird from my according to the flesh perspective that had driven me before that. There was a dude in there who, he wore salt and pepper corduroys, and he had BO every day. And he was the most brilliant, God-loving Christian in this whole group. And I thrived on hanging out with that guy because there was the life of Jesus just flowed from that guy. And I remember I was really marveling at my first couple of months as a Christian about how what I had in common now with these folks transcended all this nonsense of coolness, social status, all this kind of stuff. And I mentioned this to this fellow who was mentoring me, and he said, "You know, Joe, Jesus prayed for that for you 2,000 years ago." And I said, "What?" He took me to John 17, where Jesus is praying to the Father, and he prays to God that we would all be one as he and the Father are one. And he says, "I pray not just for these, but for those who are going to believe in my name in the future." And that just blew my mind, that this, just a whole new perspective on people based on a whole new perspective on Jesus of Nazareth, on God's Messiah. And then I look at a new life purpose. My goodness, if you had told me I was going to be a Greek teacher and a preacher back in 1974, I would have told you are absolutely nuts. That night I came into Community Baptist and that pastor read that verse to me. That was the only second time I'd ever been in a church willingly in my life. And, of course, the pastor, it's the evening service, and he's all happy to have a new convert in the midst. So he says, "Hey, Joe, you want to come up and tell the people what happened to you?" I go, "Sure." And I walked up behind the podium, and he goes, "Tell them what happened to you, Joe." And I go, "I became a Christian." And he had to give my testimony. I couldn't even talk. Now I can't stop talking. So it's just remarkable. Now, some of you who were raised in the church, when you hear my story or stories like mine, you might get testimony envy. Because you can't point to a time, you can't point to some dramatic moment when your life was turned totally upside down and changed from the inside out. But I'm here to tell you that your life is as radically different as mine. If you had not become a Christian, if you had not grown up in the church, if you had not had the path you have in Jesus and had gone a totally unchristian path from family and the whole deal, you would be a totally different human being than you are today. That's just reality, a whole new life. Now, let's focus a little bit. Uh-oh, we lost it. I'm going to have you go ahead. Here we go. We're going to focus on, let's see. I think I probably need a new battery in this thing because it's buzzing is probably what's going on. So I'm going to be talking. You go ahead and give me both. Go ahead and click again back there. Yes, okay. We're going to talk first about peace with God, what I'm calling the multifaceted jewel of the atonement. And what this is about is, this morning we're looking at the doctrine of reconciliation. That's Paul's buzzword in the passage when we're talking about peace with God through the death of Christ. And reconciliation is one of several images that the Bible uses to talk about what happened when Jesus died on the cross. This gets us back at one level to what we talked about last week when we talked about God being totally other in nature than we are as human beings. God is infinite, we're finite, God's eternal, God's immaterial. I mean, on and on and on. God is so other, so big, so huge, so different that human language falls short. We, with our human language, folks, we can't get to the essence of God. We can't even get to the essence of God's acts in history on our behalf. We have to use pictures, analogies, metaphors, stories, and things like that to talk about what God is like and what the death of Christ really means. Case in point, we call God our Father, don't we? The Bible calls him our Father. God is not our biological father. That is an image, a biblical, spirit-inspired image that the Bible uses to help us learn something about God's love and care for us. Jesus is called the Good Shepherd. Jesus was not a shepherd. We are not literally sheep. Jesus was a carpenter. But that imagery is very, very valuable because it tells us something that is absolutely true about Jesus' relationship with us. And it's in that same passage that Jesus is called a shepherd. He's called the door of the sheepfold. Now, he can't be the door and the shepherd, right? And so we see these images. And so the Bible uses all these images to try to show us what God is like. And here, when we come to the death of Christ, we have a series of images. In fact, what happened at that history-changing moment outside Jerusalem in the first century AD was so profound and world-changing that the New Testament writers have to ransack the Old Testament and their social world to come up with enough images to try to communicate the significance of Christ's death on our behalf. So we have images like this first one here. Redemption, this marketplace, this idea that we were slaves to sin and that God came along and bought us and now we're slaves to Christ, we're slaves to God. The second one on here, another image, the image of the temple. And again, these are all just images from the Old Testament and images from daily life for people in the ancient world. The image of a temple where the wrath of God is appeased. Now, Jesus was not really sacrificed at a temple, burnt to a crisp as a whole burnt offering. He died a death on a cross. But this temple imagery teaches us something about the significance of that death on our behalf. The next one, justification, the courtroom. Here's a totally different image from human life. It teaches us something else, that God pronounces us not guilty based on the death of Christ. And then finally, the doctrine of reconciliation. And you can give us, let's see, there we go there. That's where we're at today. Now, here the imagery is the home, and it has to do with relationships. Now, I want us to really drill down here this morning and wrestle with this idea of reconciliation and see if we can't see what it's all about here. The dictionaries give us two definitions of this word. There's one, and there's the other one. I think this is working now. It seems to be reacting, so I'll go ahead and run it. And they're very, very different. At least they're related, but they're different. The first one just talks about reconciliation being to reestablish an interrupted or broken relationship. It doesn't say why. It doesn't say what caused that relationship to be interrupted. It could have been something kind of negative, you know, a disagreement, a falling out, but it could have been something as simple as, moving away to college and that relationship with that roommate and that friend is just not being cultivated anymore. And then you find that person again. The second one is much more pointed, isn't it? It says to exchange hostility for a friendly relationship. Here it's as clear as a bell that there was some serious negative stuff between the two parties before that relationship was restored. Now, how many of you have, going back to the first definition, how many of you, because of social media, have reconnected with people you never would have reconnected with otherwise from high school, college? And yeah, so many of us. It's been one of the blessings of social media. There are a few, okay? And one of the most remarkable things that happened to me was not a social media thing, but it had to do with this outfit here. Go ahead and click the slide. This is my latest musical adventure. We're called Lex and the Feral Cats. You know, I know. finally I can scratch off my bucket list. I've always wanted to be a feral cat, you know. But anyway, that lady in black there holding the microphone, her name's Alexandria, she's Lex, and the other questionable characters there with playing the instruments are the feral cats, yours truly there on the right. Now, here's what happened here that was such a trip was and how I connected with these guys, because they're across town in Pasadena. I was at Susie's over here in Hermosa for the Blue Sunday Afternoon Blues Jam. We're out on the patio, and I'm talking to one of the musicians there, and the cool thing about it is these guys end up asking me, what do you do for a living? And I smile and say, I'm glad you asked. And it's just always an open door. And so I shared with this guy, and he goes, you teach New Testament? He goes, the last guitar player in my band was a New Testament professor. There can't be too many of you guys. And I go, well, what's his name? And he said, his name's Tony Tetro. And go ahead and click back there. So I discover this guy I went to seminary with. Talbot graduating class of 1984. It was just really remarkable. So that was where an interrupted relationship was reestablished. Tony and I didn't have any fights in seminary. We were good buddies, but we didn't even know each other. We played music. We were so too busy doing Greek and buying books and selling musical equipment to, But at any rate, so that's that. But now, so which of these two ways of talking about reconciliation is Paul using in the passage when he talks about God reconciling us to himself through the death of Christ? We don't know from the passage itself, because Paul doesn't tell us what the nature of the relationship was before we were reconciled. However, this is one of a handful of passages where Paul teaches about the doctrine of reconciliation, and we can learn from the other passages what Paul means when he talks about God reconciling us. And so go ahead and put up both of those passages there, Tim. That'll be fine. The first one is from Romans 5, a key passage where the word reconciliation is used several times. Paul says, while we were still sinners, while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son. And then over in Ephesians 2, Paul's talking about hostility between two racial groups, Jews and Gentiles, and how that hostility is dealt with as our hostility toward God is taken care of in the cross. And so he says of Jesus, he himself is our peace, who has made us both one, and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility, that he might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. So clearly, when Paul uses the word reconciliation, he's using it of the exchange of what was a hostile relationship between us and God. For I would add, more than simply a friendly relationship, an intimate familial relationship. Now, I think a lot of us, well, certainly when I reflect back on when I became a Christian, I think, well, wait a minute, Paul, I wasn't hostile to God. I wasn't interested in God. I was just kind of indifferent. There just wasn't any room for God in my life till my life caved in and I started searching spiritually for some answers. But I wasn't hostile to God. But I was. I was part of a hostile humanity. And it's important to understand that when Paul and these writers are dealing with these broad theological truths, they're often thinking in terms big picture of us as a human race, not simply my personal experience or yours. And this is a case in point. It goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden, where God sets things up perfectly for Adam and Eve, and they basically raise their fists in God's face and decide to disobey him and go their own way. And folks, if there was ever any doubt that the human race is at its most basic posture hostile to God, we see it in living color at the cross of Christ. Think about this. One time in all of human history, in one place, to one people, God bridged the gap between eternity and time, if you will, became a human being, and his mercy and grace came to show us what he was like. And what did we as a human race do when God showed up? We hung him on a Roman cross. We murdered him. That's hostility at its worst, folks. And here's Paul's point, and the amazing thing is, at the very moment we were spewing out
the most hostile expression of our attitude toward God in human history, hanging God himself on a cross. God was, through that very act, reconciling the world to himself. Wow. Wow. A new life pathway, peace with God. Paul tells us that this happens in a very specific way. Paul says that Paul says Christ and Christ God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them. Not counting their trespasses against them. Anybody have bring a wallet to church? Anybody bring a credit card? I got one right here. You got one? You got a credit card with you? Everybody have a credit card with you? Well, we'll trust you to put it in the offering plate. Just kidding. Just kidding. Here's my credit card, Hilton Honors. Number is 4147. No, I'm not going to read the number to you. Well, you want that little number on the back too? Okay. When Paul talks about counting, not counting their trespasses against them, he's using accounting terms from the ancient world. So imagine you get online and you're checking your credit card statement, and everything you bought is accounted to your account. You owe money for this, you owe money for that, you owe money for this, blah, 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 blah. And this is kind of Paul's picture of our sin as we are trespass, we break God's laws and sin against God. Bam, bam, bam. You know, the ledger in heaven just gets loaded up. Now, if you run your credit card too high and you can't pay it back, in our culture, you can do an end run. You can get one of those companies that you pay them a percentage to negotiate with the credit card company and get you off the hook. Or you can, if it's worse comes to worse, you can declare bankruptcy, you know, ollie-ollie auction free, and you don't have to pay the money. Well, in the ancient world, debt didn't work like that. There were no end runs. So you just were thrown in prison until you paid the debt off, or your family did, or somebody did. And if you didn't, you died in prison. And this is the imagery here. Our sins rack up. Bam, 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 bam. We owe a debt, folks, that we can never pay. But God paid it for us in Christ. God paid it for us in Christ through the death of Christ. Paul says, we've concluded this, that one has died for all. Therefore, all have died, and he died for all, that those who might live, those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. And then this amazing verse, if you want to memorize an awesome verse, this is the one. It summarizes the whole gospel, 2 Corinthians 5:21, for our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. I've put a little diagram up here on the screen. You'll notice the contrast between our faithfulness and Jesus' faithfulness. This is what I like to call the great exchange. Our unfaithfulness, we, as we read in this passage and elsewhere in Scripture, have sinned and fallen far short of the glory of God and are accountable to God because of that. The only person in human history who ever got it right was Jesus. It says here in our passage, he knew no sin. And we need to understand that kind of from the biblical way of knowing. The word know is even used in the Bible of making babies, okay? And so it's this kind of this idea of intimate knowledge. Yes, Jesus knew about sin. Certainly he knew about sin. But he didn't know sin in the sense of having committed sin and thereby gaining firsthand knowledge of sin. And the Bible's really clear about this again and again, that Jesus lived a sinless life. So Jesus lived a sinless life, we have lived sinful lives, and because of that, what God has done in Christ, go ahead and give me two clicks there, one more, great. God has put our sin on Jesus. He made him to be sin. And what Paul means by that is that God made Jesus to be a sin offering to take care of our sins. He made him to be sin who knew no sin. Many of us are familiar with this side of reconciliation. Not as many of us give much thought to what's coming up here now. A couple more. Yes, that not only has God wiped away our sin and put it on Jesus, but God has taken the perfect life of Jesus, the righteousness of God, the righteousness of Christ, and he has put it on us. He has made us to become the righteousness of God. This is the gospel, folks, and this is what we celebrate as we come to communion. One more set of slides and we'll wrap things up, and this is not on your outline, but this is really important to see this. We use a phrase in our kind of popular Christian lingo. We talk about getting right with God. And I'm increasingly disliking that phrase because it sort of implies that there's something we do to get right with God. Folks, if this passage is any indication, God does the getting, okay? It's all from God's side. Certainly we need to respond with faith to God's plan of salvation. But one of the things I like to do is ask myself, who are the actors and who are the recipients in a biblical passage? And here, talking about reconciliation, at every point, God is the actor. Check this out. All this from God, Paul says. God did the reconciling, who through Christ reconciled us, gave us the ministry of reconciliation, was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, entrusting to us the message, making his appeal. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no. God is the actor. He is the agent. He is the subject of verb after verb after verb in this passage. And notice our part there in black underline. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. Become the righteousness of God. God has done it all. It's just up to us to receive his goodness, his grace, his love. So as we come to communion now, we have great reason to be just marvel at what God has done for us, sending his son Jesus to die for our sins and to give us a whole new life. Let's pray.